I also would like to give the floor to Mr. Kent Hustedt, member of the Swedish Parliament, Vice President of the OSCE Parliamentary Assembly.
Dear Mr. Tokayev, honorable colleagues, dear friends, ladies and gentlemen, it's a real honor and a pleasure for me as Vice President of the OSCE Parliamentary Assembly, as well as a Swedish Member of Parliament, to participate in this international conference about religions against terrorism. I would like to express my gratitude and thank you to President Nazarbayev for the hospitality shown to us. And I also would like to say thank you to the Speaker, Mr. Tokayev, Speaker of the Senate of the Republic of Kazakhstan, for organizing this important event. It's given me the opportunity to speak on the role of interparliamentary diplomacy in promoting interfaith tolerance. I'm proud to represent the OSCE, which is home to 57 states, but also because of OSCE is an inclusive organization. That means that we have a great role to play in various conflicts. For example, not to mention the Minsk process as a very recent example where OSCE tries to play a very constructive role. I could mention more, but I think this is the way we need to work, to be inclusive and not exclusive, and trying to confront various points of views in a constructive manner. Terrorism, unfortunately, is a word we have had to get used to. Just a quick glimpse at the homepage of the United Nations, you can see how the statements are following each other. 12 of May, Iraq, UN Security Council strongly condemns terrorist attacks in Baghdad. 17 May, 16, Iraq, UN envoy condemns string of terrorist bombings targeting crowded Baghdad markets. 23 May, Ban condemns terrorist attacks killing dozens of civilians in two coastal Syrian cities. 25 May, Security Council condemns terrorist attacks in cities on Syrian coast. And it goes on and on and on. Terrorism is, from the beginning, a French word. It is terror, that means to scare people. And that is what terror is about, to scare people. And today, terrorism and its consequences are very obvious to many of us. Either we are involved in trying to fight terrorism, or we see the consequences of the terrorism. And I will come back to that. I think we need to have a response, and I would like to start with that, a response to this that is collective. The threat of terrorism is transnational, and our response must therefore also be multilateral. The United Nations has a unique and important asset to join up and make available to counter narratives and ideologies of terrorism. Beyond measures to enhance security, the UN should focus on efforts of implementing its action plan to prevent violent extremism, which my country, Sweden, is strongly a supporter of. Regional cooperation and regional organizations like OSCE, the organization I represent, can also play a very important role. The UN can use its convening power and bring together relevant regional, intergovernmental organizations and religious organizations in various mechanisms. It can also be individual countries who take the lead, like, for example, Kazakhstan in this case, to bring together political leaders, religious leaders, and others in a way to find a common understanding and a mutual approach to these challenges. The African Union, the League of Arab States, the Organization of Islamic Cooperation, the European Union, the Alliance of Civilizations, and the Union for Mediterranean, they all bring clear value added to the global effort to establish programs, networks, etc., and cooperation to fight violent extremism. Secondly, we need more different actors. Governments and multilateral organizations is not sufficient. I think we as parliamentarians and religious leaders also play a very important role in this endeavor. We need to have peaceful exchanges and dialogue, a multitude of actors creating resilience through inclusive dialogue, because it's also about preventing terrorism from occurring. And that might just be the most difficult part of it, not just dealing with the occurrence of terrorism and the consequences of terrorism, but actually try to prevent terrorism. We must recognize that more research is needed into the psychology of violent extremism. The narratives, violent and inhumane as they are attractive to some people. I mean, we need to be honest. People are recruited also from my country. Several of hundreds of people have gone from my country to fight with ISIS, for example. So nobody is prevented from this. Our understanding of radicalization process are still too poor. The key to success would involve research onto young people. Sweden therefore fully supports Security Council Resolution 2250 and the work of the Secretary General's Special Envoy on Youth, Ahmad Al-Hamdawi. Just the other week, thirdly, we must target the root causes. Destructive narrative sometimes occurs because of embedding context. Terrorism and violent extremism feeds on grievances, which they do not solve but nurture. This is the logic of instrumentalization that terrorist and extremist organizations employ. Economic and social issues, lack of dignity, corruption, democratic deficiencies, and human rights violations are sometimes part of the radicalization context. And so we must tackle the challenges resolutely, not at least by implementing the 2030 agenda. But other threats that underpin ideologies of terrorism and violent extremism must also be addressed forcefully. Those include racism, hatred, acts of violence based on Islamophobia, antisemitism, and Afrophobia. We must refrain from all form of scapegoating and fear-mongering. Targeting a certain religion, region, nationality, or ethnic group plays right into the hands of the terrorist ideology that we seek to counter. Interfaith dialogue and education play a very critical role in reducing such tendencies. Fourthly, and last, we need to jointly share the consequences of the terror. We need to join hands in fighting and preventing terror. We need to join hands and efforts in fighting terror when it occurs, but we also need to share the consequences of terrorism. In Europe, of course, we have had a refugee flow, which have been quite overwhelming. My country have received the largest number of refugees per capita in the whole of Europe. And we welcome them and we try to do our best to host them and to make them a good life in our country. But it's too difficult if we are too few to share it. I know Germany and Austria also have taken a great burden in this case, and of course the immediate recipient countries like Greece and Italy also have very difficult situation. But the burdens and the consequences of terrorism needs to be shared. It also is a matter of helping, supporting, fighting poverty. And as we know, the other week there was the meeting in Istanbul where the Secretary General of the United Nations convened the World Humanitarian Summit. We need to contribute as much as we can jointly to development aid, but also to support the United Nations as a strong leader in this area. So to conclude, terrorists seek to divide and spread fear and our response, our counter-narrative and our actions must be the one of inclusiveness, unity and trust. Real dialogue based on equality and dignity of all people is certainly the best antidote of racism, xenophobia and Islamophobia. So with that, I want to encourage us to work closer, to contribute as much as we can, both of fighting the terrorism, but also share the burden of the consequences of terrorism. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hastedt, for your very informative